From the far reaches of the Milky Way galaxy, it's Retro Nerd Girl with a film review for you. Today, I'll be reviewing the movie Flash Gordon, released in 1980, starring Sam Jones, Melody Anderson, and Max von Sydow. Directed by Mike Hodges. The synopsis is, a football player and a travel agent are kidnapped by a deranged scientist who is trying to save the Earth from an attack from another world. They travel to the planet Mongo on his rocket ship and battle to save their planet. The story of Flash Gordon actually begins with Buck Rogers, who was a fictional character from an adventurous sci-fi space opera created by Philip Francis Nolan in the novella Armageddon, 2019 AD, first published in the August 1928 issue of the pulp magazine Amazing Stories. The character gained massive popularity and became a comic strip in 1929, syndicated to 47 newspapers. This led to a radio series in 1932, a bevy of merchandise, and a film and television serial. This was the first of its kind, but many competitors took notice of the attention and the money that Buck Rogers was generating. Newspaper giants of the time, King Features Syndicate Incorporated, owned by Hearst Communications, wanted something of the same success. They unsuccessfully tried to get the rights to the John Carter of Mars stories by Edgar Rice Burroughs, published in 1912. Comic strip writer Alexander Gillespie Raymond Jr. was approached to create a Sunday page that could compete with Buck Rogers. The president of King Features, Joe Connolly, wanted it to be similar to the fantastic adventures of Jules Verne. Alexander was inspired by the Philip Wiley and Edgar Balmer novel When Worlds Collide in 1933, adopting the theme of an approaching planet threatening the planet Earth with an athletic hero, his girlfriend, and a scientist traveling to the planet by rocket. The first versions of the written stories did not have enough action to make the cut, but with the help of ghostwriter Don Moore, Flash Gordon first appeared in January of 1934. The strip was an instant hit of the 1930s, which included lucrative sales and licensing merchandise similar to Buck Rogers' success, and even eclipsed it. Many similar adventure comics emerged, like Brick Bradford, Don Dixon in the Hidden Empire, Speed Spalding, and the eventual revival of John Carter of Mars. It wasn't long that Flash Gordon had to be seen in live action. In 1934, Universal purchased the rights to make a film, and Flash Gordon made his debut in the movie serial starring the magnificent Larry Buster Crabbe in 1936. By the way, Buster Crabbe went on to play Buck Rogers a year later. So for those who don't know what movie serials are, it's a chapter or an episode of a story that was screened at movie theaters every week in sequential order that typically ended with a dramatic cliffhanger, compelling the audience to return the following week to see how Flash Gordon escaped his doom. Movie serials were so epic at the time that it inspired a whole generation of children to go to the movies to see them, no matter what the feature films were. In particular, they would attend the Saturday matinee, which included animated cartoons, newsreels, and two feature films at a discounted price. This was a common practice from 1914 until about the 1950s, when episodic stories were guaranteed to get a larger audience from television. Originally, the serials were a trilogy: Flash Gordon 1936, Flash Gordon's Trip to Mars in 1938, and Flash Gordon Conquers the Universe in 1940. These serials were later arranged into feature films, all of which I have seen and fell in love with when I was a child watching old movies and on some late night weekend marathon viewing. To give you an idea of how impactful these films were, Flash Gordon in 1936 was selected for preservation in the United States National Film Registry by the Library of Congress as being culturally historically or aesthetically significant in 1996. There was a live-action TV show starring Steve Holland from 1954 to 1955, with 39 episodes which exposed a new generation of children to the property. Italian-American film producer Dino De Laurentiis, who produced and co-produced more than 500 films during his lifetime, decided to buy the rights to the property and pursued the idea of making a film in the 1970s. Federico Fellini and George Lucas optioned the rights to make the film, but negotiations fell through for them both. George Lucas, in particular, was most likely to have been exposed to the television show, being about the age of 10 at the time. However, he was indeed influenced by the 1930s movie serials, which he has talked about in several interviews. King Features Syndicate released the three Flash Gordon serials to major networks in the 1950s and changed the titles to Space Soldiers as not to confuse the viewers. Lucas's failed attempt at getting Flash Gordon led to the decision to create his own space opera, Star Wars: A New Hope, in 1977. It is very easy to see all of the ways that the movie and the franchise was inspired by Flash Gordon, having a crawling text prologue in the beginning of the film, a blonde lead, the coming together of three heroes, a princess with two giant pony buns, a city in the clouds, and his stories became a trilogy. Strangely enough, the success of Star Wars inspired the making of the 1980s Flash Gordon film. Dino revved into high gear to get a director for the film. He came close to hiring Nicholas Roeg off the success of The Man Who Fell to Earth in 1976, who wanted Debbie Harry to play Princess Aura and Keith Carradine to be Ming the Merciless. He also wanted to get rid of the action and the drama and make Flash into a god among men or a metaphysical messiah. That idea didn't go over too well with Dino De Laurentiis. Dino, considered Italian film director and producer, screenwriter of many spaghetti westerns, Sergio Leone. Leone refused the offer because he wanted the script to be more aligned with the original comic strips. English writer, film director, playwright, and novelist Mike Hodges was the eighth director that Dino considered. Mike must have had some magic because, according to Mike, he was hired to direct the project because Dino said he liked his face. American screenwriter, best known for his work on the Batman TV series in the 1960s, Lorenzo Simple Jr. was brought in to write the screenplay. He wrote Flash Gordon with a similar camp for the ridiculous premise, using lots of old-fashioned dialogue and overdramatic moments. The story is a complete adventure taking Earthlings Flash Gordon, Dale Arden, and Dr. Zarkov to the planet Mongo to save Earth from Ming the Merciless's attack. It's the classic premise from the movie serials and the comic strips. All of the official properties prior to this had more of a serious tone to them since they were dealing with life and death situations. Even though the situations seemed ridiculous, the characters were sincere. Although this film has moments where it truly shines and there are moments of real tension, there are also many silly comedic moments that are awkward as to make the film very lighthearted and, dare I say, a lot of fun. The dialogue is so quotable. It's one of the most quotable films of 1980 besides maybe Empire Strikes Back. It was as if the characters themselves were in on the joke, knowing what the film was and reveling in it. Now to the pacing. At 1 hour and 50 minutes, it's too long, okay? But it really goes by fast through every dazzling adventure. The challenge. The challenge in this film is the iconic villain Ming the Merciless. Ming is probably one of the best villains since 1934, being the prototype influencing many iconic movie villains, such as the Emperor in Star Wars and pretty much any mega baddie types that you can think of. Now for me, Ming is one of the main highlights of the film. He is the Emperor of Mongo, And every 1,000 years, he tests each life system in the universe with earthquakes, unpredictable eclipses, and strange craters in the wilderness. If these are taken as natural happenstance, he judges that that system is ignorant and harmless, thus sparing it. However, if the hand of Ming is recognized in these events, he judges that system dangerous. Ming uses his magical ring, which he calls upon the god Daizan to carry out his deeds. Both Ming and Daizan delight in the destruction of the chosen planet by bombarding the moon with force beams, therefore knocking it out of orbit and sending chunks of fiery moon debris crashing into the planet. This causes very unique weather anomalies that will tear the planet apart. Contrary to the dead serious personality of Ming of the serials, in the beginning of this film, Ming is a whimsical evil man with a twisted sense of humor, devoid of morality, constantly amused at the power he wields. And boy, does that man know how to enter a room. His entrance into the film is iconic. He demands total control and complete obedience of all of those in his company, no matter the cost. An excellent example of that is when he kills one of the princes of his domain, Prince Thun of Ardentia, because he could not provide a tribute to Ming. He displays to his court of royalty what happens when you fail him and if you dare to challenge him. Ming's right-hand man is Colitis, who was created for the film. He is the one that chooses Earth for Ming's entertainment and conspires with the tyrant on their nefarious schemes. The character seems a little redundant at first, but a character like Ming needs to have a henchman actually oversee his plots so he can enjoy his position of power. He can hardly be bothered with these pesky little details. And I enjoyed that fact that the film showed that he really never gets his hands dirty, so to speak. I really enjoyed the rapport between the two. Ming trusts Colitis even more than he trusts his own daughter, Princess Aura. Colitis has been given the privilege of speaking for Ming at times and has been offered the hand of Aura in marriage, making him next in line for the throne, ensuring his power. I like that fact because we get to know exactly what is motivating this character and why he's doing what he's doing. And by the way, he has some of the best lines in the film as well. When he's eventually killed in the film, Ming has to be more present, and Ming's tone changes into a more serious one. At one point, he tries to recruit Flash Gordon in hopes of replacing his loss in some form or another. And I felt like that was so real for his character. The empathy in this film is a little lacking, in my opinion. Now, don't get me wrong, I love all of the characters for being so iconic. However, so much happens in such a short amount of time, it seems as if our main three heroes from Earth are just quickly smashed together and their personalities are boiled down to the basics in a hurry. I'm not sure if the filmmakers were banking that everyone knew these characters already, but it was at a detriment to the story because they came off very lackluster and even a bit old-fashioned from the 1930s and the 1940s. Again, I still had fun watching them, and the empathy really does improve by the end. In the comic strip, Flash Gordon is a polo player and a Yale University graduate, making him an intellectual jock. In this film, he's a star quarterback for the New York Jets, which makes him more of an average guy, but also a hero on the onset. The story starts with Flash meeting travel agent Dale Arden on a private plane coming from vacation. Ironically, she's afraid of flying, and Flash tries to comfort her while some awkward flirting occurs. Suddenly, one of Ming's magical anomalies hits the plane and takes out the pilots, while the Earth is facing what looks like climate Armageddon. They crash land the plane in a remote laboratory of a seemingly insane former NASA scientist, Dr. Hans Zarkov, who kidnaps them on a rocket ship to Mongo in order to make friends with the aliens in order to save Earth. This is pretty much the only thing we learn about our characters. You could say that maybe we get the most backstory for Dr. Zarkov being a survivor of Nazi Germany and his wife drowning in a backyard pool when he's being programmed to be an agent of Ming. You get the sense that Flash Gordon is American as apple pie and an upright citizen. Unlike his former versions, there's something a little bit more innocent and naive about this version of the character. He's definitely likable, and the empathy for him grows as the film continues. Flash and Dale begin the film as strangers, and by the end, they are an engaged couple. And I've seen this film for so many years and not realized that they got engaged in the film after having just 3 conversations together. Their relationship is so awkward and unnatural without any development. As well, Dale's character was changed from a news reporter to a travel agent. I thought that was going to play a factor in the film, but it never does. From a writing perspective, these characters are not the focus of the story. The twists and turns of their adventures are. The people of Munger are way more interesting and given more depth of character. We have Princess Aura, Ming's daughter, who has many lovers among the kingdoms. And upon seeing Flash Gordon in all of his glory fighting off Imperial guards, she decides to risk everything and have him as a lover. She goes against her father because she's so privileged and spoiled. Always thinks that she can manipulate her way into having whatever she wants. She's a bit ridiculous as a character, but she's progressive, fun, and also naive. However, Aura gets an arc in the film. She learns that her father's cruelty can extend to her as well. She also learns what suffering is and becomes an asset to the Earthlings. Prince Baron is the ruler of a forest region of Mongo called Arboria, which gained inspiration from Robin Hood. These guys are into tree houses, archery, deadly manhood rituals, and torturing trespassers in their swamplands. You could spend the whole movie learning about their strange culture. The prince is extremely hostile to Flash Gordon initially because he is madly in love with Princess Aura. But after Flash saves his life, he too has a character arc to fight against Ming and swears his allegiance to Flash. Ming keeps the kingdoms of Mongo fighting against each other so that they are too busy to overthrow him. A prime example of that is how he encourages the rivalry between Prince Baron and Prince Vulton, ruler of the winged birdmen of Sky City that floats above Arboria. This is yet another fascinating culture we only get a teeny tiny taste of, but by goodness, it is so delicious. Things like their wings, are they mechanical or are they real wings with armor on top of them? It's a strange little detail that I'm focusing on, but it's a small example of how much story there is to tell in this story. In the throne room scene, you can see a colorful display of so many kingdoms represented, some altered from the original comic serial for the film's budget. If all of these kingdoms work together instead of fighting against each other, they could break free of Ming's cruelty and misuse of power. So this is one rather nice subplot that I enjoyed during the film. Now the technical aspects. The technical aspects of the film is a mixed bag. This was due to the fact that there was a great deal of confusion during the production. Firstly, Dina De Laurentiis wanted to go all out for this production, being a fan of Flash Gordon himself. However, he and Mike Hodges had different ideas of how the film should be. As well, there was a mix of English and Italian crew members at the London studio, so there was a bit of a language barrier on set and a lack of communication, which proved extremely challenging. Dino De Laurentiis also hired Italian costume designer and production designer Danilo Donati, who previously won 2 Academy Awards for Best Costume Design for his work in Romeo and Juliet in 1968 and Fellini's Casanova in 1976. He was given the green light to work autonomously, which was frustrating for Mike Hodges, but he tried to make it work as best as he could. Donati had incredible ideas that were unleashed on the production. This is where the film really gets its bold style. He is responsible for all of the wonderful costumes for the Mongonians in the film, helping us see the majesty of the Emperor's court. They were all so very extravagant and detailed, many of them weighing up to 70 pounds. Many of the looks had direct inspiration from the comics and also had some modern inspiration from the 60s and the 70s high fashion couture. And my goodness, I loved it. Wow. Every costume more elaborate and ornate than the next. I am such a big fan of this kind of surreal costuming. And when I was a kid, I hoped that in the future, which would be the present day, we'd be wearing these elaborate dresses and just like as a normal thing. Instead of jeans and t-shirts, we'd be wearing headdresses and huge sequin gowns. I don't know. I was kind of a crazy kid who loved sci-fi, but you know, there's still hope for the future. I'll cross my fingers. Now, speaking of the 1960s, the film derives a lot of inspiration from Dino De Laurentiis's other sci-fi adventure flick, Barbarella, released in 1968. Oh, what a film. I love that film. If you play these two films back to back, it almost feels as if they are part of the same universe. And you can really see the similarities and how Flash Gordon bears about the same imaginative vision of the alien worlds and techniques used for flying characters, the ideas used for space travel as a psychedelic trip, and even the comedic tone is very similar. The sets were massively impressive with inspiration from the original film serials in the 1930s with Art Deco style, keeping the rich colors and fantasy in mind for a comic book world brought to life. Now, the visuals for the world of Mongo was astounding, with a cacophony of color and shapes. The trippy skies and constant movement was achieved by swirling dyes of different color through tanks of water with bright lights behind them. I enjoyed this so much because I just love it when artists really go all out to show us what they think other worlds would look like. Many of the fantastic visuals were incredible from time to time until we got to the uncanny valley a few times with a lot of the blue screen chroma keying that was a little bit on the obvious side. They lacked the budget and the technology to pull it off for what they were going for, and to be honest, the technique was not perfected at this time. But I did hear that the Blu-ray edition of Flash Gordon did clean up a lot of the visuals. Now, sadly, Flash Gordon lives in the shadow of Star Wars. When people say that this movie is a ripoff of Star Wars, which I think is so unfair as a comparison because it's nothing like Star Wars at all. Star Wars mainly concentrated on making science fiction look real, whereas this movie really wanted to play up the fantasy of a nostalgic comic book and that sense of wonder you get when you turn through the pages. The nostalgic element could also be seen in the design of the retro vintage spaceships in the film, not veering away too far from the one seen in the serial films in 1936. And I'm so tickled by those simple little designs, and it was yet another unique feature in this film. The battle with Prince Baron and Flash Gordon in the Sky City was one of the best scenes in the movie for me. That fight scene felt very raw and wild and insane. The stakes are so very high, with high tension, and you don't know what's going to happen. It definitely had a sense of excitement about that scene that keeps you on your toes, guessing if they would survive the whips, the rising spikes in the floor, and the rotating platform above a swirly abyss. What a wonderful action scene. And that was achieved by having four crew members operating hydraulics on a rotating platform 30 feet above ground. It's a fantastic practical effect to accompany one of my favorite battles. The amazing and memorable soundtrack and score was done by the renowned rock band Queen, along with incredible orchestral arrangements conducted by Howard Blake. Originally, Mike Hodges considered hiring the band Pink Floyd to do it, which would have given the film a completely different tone. Mike went with Queen, But at the time, Dina De Laurentiis had no idea who the band was and wasn't too keen on the final soundtrack initially. Luckily, Mike was insistent and got his way. The band was immediately interested when they were introduced to the project, and it became their first movie soundtrack. Queen's music created a certain energy, strumming up a wonderful expectation of epic proportions. The band was in on the joke that Flash Gordon is a hero for dreamers, and this film was a sort of rock opera for the ages. Their very unique metal sound, mixed with synthesizers, wicked riffs, and random falsettos, was rare to be used in a film like this at the time. By the way, Queen went on to do yet another thunderously epic soundtrack for Highlander in 1986. Now the performances. Although filming was difficult, on set there was a good rapport amongst everyone, and everyone speaks so highly of their experience. Dino De Laurentiis expected to make 3 films, just like the serials, and the main cast members were signed for them if the film did well. Arnold Schwarzenegger was considered for the role of Flash Gordon, but his thick accent at the time was too great of a problem for a production to work around. Dino De Laurentiis' mother-in-law sought dashing 25-year-old actor Sam Jones on an episode of the Dating Game television show and declared that he was Flash Gordon. What sealed the deal is that Dino De Laurentiis agreed, since Sam and Buster Crabbe indeed looked very similar at about the same age. He hired Sam to take on his first starring role. Sam had the physical acumen to perform a lot of his own stunts, being 6'3 and a former semi-professional football player. There's a lot of criticism about Sam's acting in the film, and there is a little backstory about that. In the documentary, Life After Flash, released in 2019, he explained that after the film wrapped principal photography, there was a conflict between Dino De Laurentiis and the young actor, in which he took guidance from his manager to leave the production cold before they were able to get pickup shots and voiceovers. It was a precarious position because most of his voice was dubbed in secret by actor Peter Marinker. To me, part of the charm of the movie lies in the portrayal of Flash Gordon by both. It lends something very unique. Ming the Merciless was wonderfully portrayed by 50-year-old Swedish actor and director Max von Sydow, who shaved his head for the role and donned costumes weighing over 70 pounds. He looks like he's having so much fun being Ming, and what more can I say? He is an amazing actor. He's just wonderful in everything. What he brings to the character really matched the tone for the rest of the film, being more whimsical and precocious. Canadian actor Melody Anderson was growing in fame for her many guest appearances since 1970 on television movies and shows like Logan's Run, Welcome Back, Kotter, and Battlestar Galactica. Melody really channeled the versions of Dale Arden that came before her with a very retro performance. Much of it came from her dialogue, but there's something very spicy and fun that she added to the character in a very genuine way. As a big fan of the serials when he was a young boy, Brian Blessed was very aggressive about playing the part of his favorite character in the franchise, Prince Vulten. Seeing Brian in the role, he's perfect for it, embellishing the character with a very larger-than-life showmanship and likability. As well, more than any other character, he has the most quotable lines in the film, mainly due to his magnanimous, charismatic delivery. Brian has said that the Queen of England told him that Flash Gordon was her favorite film, and even asked him to say his favorite line in the movie, "Gordon's alive!" for her. That was my impression. I hope it wasn't too bad. It's one of my favorite lines, too. He had a knack for stealing every scene he was in because he not only seemed to be enjoying himself, but he said that he was so excited to get to work every day. A few notable actors in the film were 1975's Rocky Horror Picture Show director Richard O'Brien, Deep Roy from Charlie and the Chocolate Factory, released in 2005, and John Hollis, who had a role in Star Wars Episode V, The Empire Strikes Back, released in 1990 as Lobot. Now my wish list. Now don't get me wrong, I love this film, but This has some serious problems. I hope you'll bear with me as I nerd out on the details. Now, I really enjoyed the film, but it was vastly underwritten. I wish the film had found a way to develop the Earthling characters a little bit more, especially Flash and Dale. I think it was a mistake to have them just meet suddenly and have a relationship with no development. But it would have been nice if they were already a couple that had spent their vacation together, and we would root for them all the more. I also wish that Flash had a deeper backstory. Brian Blessed said that he was in contact with Buster Crabbe, who would have been happy to play Flash's father. But the idea got turned down. And to be honest, that was a big mistake, because I would have loved to have seen that. Not only because of Buster Crabbe, but the opportunity for Flash to have some emotional connection to his life on Earth, and why it's so important to him personally to save it. Dr. Zarkov was played by Topol, who is a brilliant actor famous for his role in Fiddler on the Roof, released in 1971. With such an incredible actor at their disposal, his character was not given enough to do and often just seen hanging around in the background. In the serials, Dr. Zarkov is a big deal, actively assisting Flash Gordon utilizing Mongo technology. In fact, Ming sees the doctor as an asset for his skills as a scientist, not as a useless spy. I wish that they were able to capture and develop the importance of having this brilliant scientist along for the adventure, even if it was just to work on how to save Earth. Which leads me to another lost plot point of saving Earth. They barely remembered this plot point by the end, and I wish that it had more of a scientific believability that was incorporated in the story. It just feels like an incomplete idea. I also wish there was some sense of wonder for the Earthlings arriving on the alien world. Meaning aliens or winged men, it just seems like nothing phases our characters. At the end of the film, Dale says, "It's a little too quiet around here for me." And I came from New York. I mean, New York is fun and it's crazy and a lot happens there, but it doesn't rival interplanetary travel and meeting aliens that can fly, okay? I'm so sorry, but it doesn't. Now, the film wraps up a little too quickly for me. I must confess that I really wanted a really juicy sword fight between Flash Gordon and Ming. There's a couple of scenes where you see that Ming has a sword at his side, and I really thought that they were going to do some kind of epic battle for the ages for us. We needed it and we wanted it, but it didn't happen. And I would have even settled for a sword fight with Colitis. I mean, let's be honest, that guy went out too quick in the film. We needed a nice struggle with him in it to show that he truly is a baddie, you know? Well, one piece of the story I find really kind of annoying was the Earthling's sense of superiority. It's not just morally, but even physically. And also the fact that humans had to teach the aliens how to be good people. And I appreciate the idealism, but it's too self-righteous. Now, the most important gripe that I have with this film is a subject matter that is often ignored. And although I love the personality of Ming the Merciless as a villain, I do not enjoy the racial implications of the character. Unfortunately, Ming the Merciless's origins came from something that is called Yellow Peril, which is a form of xenophobia vilifying Asians. Flash Gordon wasn't the only story doing it at the time of conception. There are many literary works of such from about the late 1800s to about 1940, including Flash Gordon's inspiration, Buck Rogers, who fought against the Mongol Reds. Ming is a Chinese surname famous for the legendary Ming Dynasty. If we weren't sure, well, the world Ming rules over is Mongo, which is a letter shy from the word Mongol, the inhabitants of Mongolia. This leads us to Genghis Khan, the famous warlord and emperor of the Mongol Empire during the 13th and 14th centuries. His empire was the largest contiguous land empire in history, starting at East Asia and stretched from Eastern Europe, Central Europe, Japan, and into the Arctic. And it scared a lot of people. And so perhaps he was the inspiration for Ming. This had become a challenge for Flash Gordon's mainstream success in this day and age. I think the intent of this film was not to encourage cultural fear, but to tell an action-adventure film and a great challenge to Flash Gordon. And I could see that the filmmakers did make an effort not to be distinct about Ming's race. However, the character of Ming is offensive by his name and the stereotype of his dress. He still represents that yellow peril of the 1934 comic. You know, I don't know what the answer is. Maybe it's time for someone to rewrite Flash's story and give him a new villain for the next generation moving forward. That's if someone thinks that this is worth the trouble and fans are willing to understand that Ming needs to change. And if they miss the good old days of Ming, well, there's always the old franchise materials to enjoy. Now, my enjoyment. Before the filming, Dina De Laurentiis was approached about using the rights for an animated NBC movie of the week. It was discussed that the film would be transformed into a TV series in 1979 to work in tandem with the movie as not to upstage it. NBC shelved the animated movie Flash Gordon, The Greatest Adventure of All until 1982. I would say that the animated TV series was my gateway to Flash Gordon, and I just loved all of the fantastic adventures and characters with this alien world. The art style of the animation was also what drew me in because the art was so very mature and not like any of those kiddie animation shows at the time. Soon after, He-Man would be my next cartoon obsession, and not only is it from the same animated company, Filmation, it had a lot of the same tones and theatrics. What I'm describing here is that after several years of dormancy, the Flash Gordon franchise was making its way through to children of 1979 and swelling up the expectations for the 1980s film. Universal promoted the film internationally and it did well. However, in the US there was a problem since losing the main actor for the film before the end of production. Sam Jones did not promote the film, so the marketing department relied on Max von Sydow to sell the movie. It is the reason why most of the movie posters prominently feature the villain instead of the hero. Ultimately, in the US, it was met with mixed reviews. The film was so divisive that even Siskel and Ebert were split on this. Even still, it was successful at the box office. A sequel could have been in the works, but there was still radio silence between Sam and Dino, thus ending the trilogy that was planned. There was an American-Canadian TV series in 2007. I was so excited for it, and the promotional material was inspiring, but it really didn't work for me visually or tonally. There were a few more animated TV shows, but the old fans really wanted a reboot. Unfortunately, Flash Gordon had failed attempts at a reboot in 2010, 2014, 2015, 2016, and lastly, a Disney-Fox collaboration with Taika Waititi was in the works up until about 2019. And it may be too great of a challenge to bring Flash Gordon to the modern age because of some of its big problems. But I think that there's a strong message to the story of Flash Gordon that is very powerful for the average person to hear. Flash isn't a superhero. He's just some guy with courage to stand up and fight against wrongdoing. He represents every man's ability to be great and an upright citizen. He sends the message that you don't have to have superpowers to change the world. We can do better and be better if we don't ignore problems and stand up and face them like Flash Gordon would. The children that saw this film back in the 1980s, myself included, never forgot the beautiful kaleidoscope of imagination intermingling with the ridiculous concepts of a non-science fiction. It's a pure fantasy in its most basic form. My rating is an 8.4. Well, that sums up my review. I hope you liked it. And if you did, I've got over 100 of these kinds of reviews. So go on ahead and browse my channel to see more reviews from me like this. Subscribe if you haven't done so already and hit the bell icon to be the very first to be notified of my next video. This is Retro Nerd Girl signing off. Take care, movie lovers. I'm off to my next review.